what is known as data preprocessing. Now, why do you need data preprocessing? With a very simple aspect called what are the problems that happen with regard to data. There is something called noise, there's something called outliers, okay, data reader, you know, duplication that is there, data missing values that are there. So all these things are problems. To avoid this, or to sort of figure out this, or sort of overcome this, there are various techniques that you see here. Okay, you got your aggregation, sampling, dimensionality reduction, feature subset selection, feature creation, discretization, binarization, variable transformation, so many techniques, 7 techniques to be very precise. Okay, now except for the last 2-3, almost all are theory based. So you basically saw what was with regard to aggregations. This refers to what? You are going to sort of join more than one attribute. The example being that you know, joining daily sales figures. Okay, like that, in that you had something called as data reduction, change of scale, more stable data, the purpose, very purpose of doing that and all. Then you came across what is known as sampling model. What is the meaning of sampling everything? All these things you saw in the previous session. Now the most important part, the dimensionality reduction, everything you saw in the previous session. Now the next feature or the next data preprocessing technique is with regard to feature subset selection. As the name suggests, we are talking about something called as a subset. Now, what is the meaning of subset? You have a set, you have a subset. So what is the meaning of subset? A sub part of a bigger program. Okay, a sub part or a very minute part of a very bigger aspect of it. Okay, so what is feature subset selection? Is a process of what? Identifying or removing as much irrelevant and redundant data information that is possible. Okay, so if you want to remove any redundancy, we are talking about place, you know, what you call feedback. Now in opting, it's all, you know, open now. There was some confusion with regard to, you know, mapping the professional electives and open electives. I think open electives is still not mapped. Okay, hopefully it will be mapped by the next feedback. So what was the redundant information we don't want with regard to feedback? We don't want any of your marks. We don't want any of your address, father name, mother name and all. No, the only thing we take with regard to your feedback is with regard to your USNs, your name and whether you are given the feedback or not. 3 fields, not more than that, right? So that's with regard to feature subset selection. What are the features I'm selecting here? Your USN, name and whether or not you are given the feedback, as simple as that. I don't want any other features. So that's what you can see here, okay? A process of identifying and removing as much relevant and redundant information as possible. So what does it do? It reduces the dimensionality data. That's what I was talking about. I don't want all the other dimensionality that is needed for me with regard to feedback. No. It allows the algorithms to operate faster and also more effectively. Okay. So what are redundant features? Redundant features, they duplicate many of all the information contained in one or more attributes. What is redundancy? Redundancy is doing same thing again and again. What are redundant features? Features which are almost similar to the features that are already available. Okay, so what is the example for it? The example is purchase price of a product and the amount of sales tax paid. Now, is it, where do you think the redundancy is coming in here? When I'm talking about a purchase amount or the purchase value of a product, I'm talking about even the tax paid, inclusion of tax paid, right? So when I have 2 fields here, what is the purchase product and amount of tax paid, unless and until I exclusively want this amount of sales tax paid, I don't need that, right? I could always go with purchase price of a product, which will include all everything, tax, that, this, everything, okay? So if you take your any retail bills, you'll probably get to know that what is the MRP, what is the discount. Discounts will always be based on MRP. Okay, so there's an MRP, there's a discount, and based on that value, you will be having what is known as the GST slab. You know, in India, we are following what is known as GST, right? So either it will be a combination of your some people will be giving a combination of your
both GSTs, or some people will be only going with the split up of things, which is CGST and SGST, which is nothing but central GST and state GST. Okay, it varies, right? 5%, sometimes 18%, depends on what type of product you're buying. Okay, so that is with regard to, you know, how redundant or the feature selection can be done. Okay, based on this, the other things which we can talk about is irrelevant features contain almost or no useful information for the data mining task. So what we can do? What is the example for it? The example is very simple. We can think of students' roll numbers, which are very, very irrelevant to the task of predicting the students' grade points. We want to predict what is the result we want your people will be able to get it in the sixth term. What we do? We take obviously your first sem, second sem, third sem, fourth sem, fifth sem marks. We take a USN, we take your name, we take your prediction of it. Do we know, does your roll number, does your address, does your father's name, mother's name, does your phone number has anything to do with prediction of your results in 6M? No. Doesn't have anything with regard to it, right? The only thing that really matters here is, of course, your past performance, which is from first semester to fifth semester. If you can plot a graph there, the generally the graph would be like this, okay? 1, 2, very much on top. 3, 4, it will generally come down. Then again from 5, it will go up, okay? From 5, 6, 7, 8, it will generally an exponential rise, okay? It will keep on increasing. But I don't know what with you people with fifth sem results, maybe it will still staying in the 3, 4 graph itself, which is a very bad thing, okay? It should have gone up right to, you know, some scale with regard to your 1 and 2, okay? Any engineering student, generally the common graph will be like this, unless and until they're highly exceptional people where the graph will sort of be sort of going up. Okay. Otherwise, it will generally be what is known as a, you know, a graph which will fall in 3 and 4, and then it will keep on rising after we go with the fifth sem results. Okay. So let's sort of look into this. Okay. What are things that we look for? What are the techniques for feature subselection or the feature selection? The techniques are, first one is with regard to embedded approach. What is that? Feature selection occurs naturally as a part of your data mining algorithm. So data mining algorithm itself will bring in feature selection approach by default, inbuilt. So during the operation of the data mining algorithm, the algorithm itself will decide which attribute to use and which to ignore. So if I can always go, when I say predict the results of 6M people, the data mining algorithm should itself be good enough to sort of take only the marks relevant, which is 1 to 5 semester marks. Any other features, it should sort of neglect. Marks and your names, that's the only two things that are relevant, right? Any other things are very much irrelevant. Your phone number will not decide what is the marks you're going to get in 6M. Okay, that is highly, you know, sort of, it may decide if you wanted to predict, you know, 10th or a PU marks, maybe your college, you know, college name, college brand may come into picture. Okay, but here I don't think so. That's also a possibility, right? 10th and PU, why cause a college name and a college brand comes into picture is because they will put in some effort. The college will put in some effort to make sure that you have a better results, because it's a, you know, what do you call, bread and butter for them also, your results. Okay, so that's the first thing. The second approach is with regard to filter approaches. So what that they do, features are selected before the data algorithm is sort of run. You're only doing it manually before the data algorithms are run on the features. Okay, the third approach is wrapper approaches. You're going to wrap it in something, right? What is it? We are going to use the data mining algorithm as a black box to find the best subset of attributes. So you must be knowing what is a black box and all, because you people are studying software testing. Of course, before that itself, you would have known what is black box. People who are more accustomed to use, you know, sort of view things like, when you're talking about aeroplane investigation, air crash investigation in Nat Geo, there used to be a very good show called Nat Geo Investigations, okay, under air crash and all. Okay. So that people will always think of what is known as black box. What is that? It's a box that contains vital information regarding what has really happened or what has really gone wrong when it comes to any sort of air crashes, right? So like that, we are going to use a data mining algorithm to figure out where people have gone wrong or which is my best attributes. Okay, that is something that people need to sort of think of. Okay, wrapper approaches. Next, what's the next thing? Feature creation. There it was, feature selection. The next approach here is feature creation. So you're creating something. There it is already there, you're selecting it. Here you're only creating it. Okay, so that is something that you need to keep in mind. So based on this, what are the things to be kept in mind? The things to be kept in mind is it involves creation of new attributes that can capture the important information in the data set. Okay, so you are creating a new attribute that can capture important information in the data set. Okay, much more efficiently than the original attributes. So what are the general methodologies here? Again, feature extraction, feature construction, mapping the data to a new space or to a new domain altogether. Okay, first one is with regard to feature extraction. See here, understand the difference. There was selection, here it is creation. Okay, so what is feature extraction? The creation of a new set of features from the original raw data is known as feature extraction. So you're creating new features from the original data. Okay, so what is the example for it? The example is we have taken with a classic example of whatever that is there in the textbook, and also the example which many of us use whenever they talk about feature extraction, because this topic is a very huge topic, feature extraction and all. It comes in even in data analytics, it comes in data analysis, even in big data analytics, everything. Anything related to data science, okay? Anything related to data, this topic is a very huge topic. Okay, so what is the? Consider a set of photographs. We have a set of photographs. Each photograph is to be classified whether or not a particular human face is there or not, or whether or not a human face is there or not. So we have a set of photographs. Think, you know, there are 100 photographs. We need to classify them. Again, remember the word, technical term called classification. I need to classify whether particular human face is present or not, or a human face is present or not. For this, what I can do? To classify this, and this needs to be done using an algorithm, not manually. Okay, so the photograph is full of pixels. Everyone knows that, right? Any image you take, it's always represented in terms of pixels. Image quality, video quality is always with regard to pixels. Okay, probably you must be knowing by now. Okay, probably, you know, you go to any YouTube, they will clearly ask you what should be the picture quality, whether it is 144 pixels, 240, 360, 480. Okay, then again, what's the next one? 720, 1080, 1080 is HD. Of course, now you have 4K resolutions and all. Okay, what is that? It's nothing but the amount of pixels that are present in per area of a image. Okay, so the photograph is full of pixels, not suitable for classification of human face. Fine. What's the next thing? If the data is processed to provide higher level features, what are the features? If the, you know, photograph is features, if the photograph is processed to add more information, okay, to add more information, such as what? You are going to add presence or absence of certain types of edges and areas that are highly correlated with the presence of human faces, then this classification can be done. So if the data mining algorithm can sort of detect certain edges or certain, what you call, features that are somewhat similar to the human face. When you think of a human face, what are the features that you can think of when a person's face is somewhat having an eye, a nose, a mouth? Okay, you got an eyebrow, you got a head. When people can sort of, when the algorithm can detect all these things, then the algorithm can sort of classify whether a particular photograph is having a human face or not. Okay, that is, and what is this adding all these, you know, certain types of edges, areas and all? That is, you are sort of adding a new feature to the photograph. That is, and where do you take that entire thing? You're taking from the original data itself. That's what you see in the first line. Creation of new set of features from the original data is known as feature extraction. Okay. Next, feature construction. You're going to construct something. How? Sometimes features in the original data, which have necessary information, is not suitable form for data mining algorithm. So in a particular data set, there is certain data which is not really working for my data mining algorithm. So what should I do? I need to convert that into something else. In this situation, what I do? One or more features constructed out of the original features can be more useful than the original features. So what is that? Example is same classic example what I have taken. See, majority of it will include the examples right from the science background. When I say science background, not computer science background, science, general science background. So you can see the example. When you divide mass by volume, see, I have a data for mass. Okay. I have the data for volume. Okay. I want a data for density. Can I do it? Yeah. I can construct. If I can able to construct a data set which has the values of mass getting divided by volume, I can get what is known as density. That's what I have done with regard to examples. And you can see the example. Density is equal to mass by volume. More, everyone who studied science will be knowing this example, right? This is with regard to feature construction. Now you see the first line. Features in the original data sets which are have the necessary information. Mass and volume are necessary information. Is not suitable form for data algorithm because I want to figure out what is the volume. I want to figure out what is the density. For that, I'll construct a data set which has m divided by v. Then I'll be able to get what is known as the density value of it. Okay. Then the third approach. What is the third approach? Mapping the entire data to a new space. Okay. So again, I'll just name this as 3. Sometimes you forget that. Okay. Now it's fine. Okay. What is it? Mapping the data to a new space. So you're basically putting all the data into a new place altogether. What is that? A totally different view of data. Entirely new data can reveal important and interesting features. A totally different view of data can reveal important and interesting features. What is that? Okay. Again, a science example we are going to take. When you take time series data, which contain periodic patterns. Okay. If there is only a single periodic pattern and not much of noise is there, then pattern can be easily detected. Okay. So what is the meaning of time series data? Probably you would have seen time series data in previous examples also when we studied last session. Okay. Last session when we talked about various types of data and all, we talked about even the time series data. Now, with regard to time series data, how do you think it will be? Time series data basically, or else I'll just show it here itself. Okay. Just one second. Hopefully, yeah, now it's visible to you. So based on here itself, I can show. Okay, what is time series data? Time series data will generally be, if you take into form of a graph, it'll be sort of like this. It can be anything like this, or it can be like this, or it can be like this, anything. Okay, what do you think this is? This is with regard to an attribute called time. Okay, and of course, this can be any values. This can be any values, and that values is represented in form of a graph like this. Now, what is this? This is with regard to time, the graph that is going to happen like this. Can I figure out the patterns like this? Yeah, I can easily figure out the patterns that this will be my lower end, or else I can show it. This will be my lower end. This is going up to the upper end. So if I put a graph or a plot a graph like this, the graph is almost coming like this. Okay, I can easily deduce the pattern that up to whatever you see till here, up to here, the graph is very much constant, right? It's very much constant. And after that, there is an exponential rise here. So you can easily figure out, maybe the time is somewhere, you're starting from around morning 6. And this comes up to around, afternoon 12. So from morning to 12, there's a constant figure out of data. You can see very clearly, there's a constant ups and downs. what you can saw. See, this is, you know, when you people get into data science, more into data science, when you go into visualization aspect of it, okay, these graphs, playing with graphs, analyzing graphs will become such a good thing, and also more like a essential thing. Okay, should be able to analyze graphs, each and everything. And what is data science? All about finding out patterns, finding out things where it can happen. You are not necessarily saying that it will happen. No, you are saying only it can happen. Okay, you can see this. There's this exponential rise after this 12 p.m. This is the most important part. Okay, why this is happening, all those things can be figured out. Based on that, you can predict what is going to happen or what needs to be done on. This is only having a single pattern data. Okay, that's what the line clearly says. You can go here and think about it. Where is that? Yeah, time series data, fine, which contains periodic patterns. Okay, if there is only a single periodic pattern, okay, or there is only one data, as you can see, there's only one graph that has been represented and not much noise. There's no noise there. Pattern can be easily detected, fine. If there are more than one sort of, patterns that needs to be done. If the number of periodic patterns, if there are number of periodic patterns and also significant amount of noise. What is significant amount of noise? Significant amount of unwanted data. Then the patterns are very, very difficult to detect. Okay, that's what they're trying to say here. At that time, what we can do? We can map this into a different thing altogether. What is the different thing altogether? The classic example is Fourier series or Fourier transform series. I don't know to what extent you people have studied. Maybe when you studied physics way back in your 12th or 11th, probably would have heard of this terminology called Fourier transform series. FTS, Fourier transform series or Fourier series transformation. Okay, based on what is the name you studied. So what is the example? The example is like this. See this? I'm converting the time domain into the frequency domain. Okay, now how it is getting converted, you can see very clearly. Okay, the time basically works through like this. I'm figuring out this into a frequency so that it becomes very easy for me to sort of analyze this. Okay, you can see the, you know, the one in the pink color coming through like this, one in the, you know, green color coming through like this. I'm converting the time domain to the frequency domain. So Fourier transformation. Fourier transformation decomposes a time domain function into a frequency. So what is this? I'm mapping from one domain to another domain. I'm changing one data into a new space, mapping the data to a new space. That's what you see in the third point. Okay. This is one more way of doing this. Okay. What's the next one? Discretization. Now, what is discretization? You would have heard of the thing called discrete. So what is that? It's a process of converting the continuous values into an ordinal value. Now, you must know what is continuous attribute. You would have studied this way back in previous sessions and also in DBMS. What is continuous attribute? It has real values. If you measuring temperature, height or weight, what is the value you put? Real values. Okay, real values that has, you know, something values like 22, 42.2. okay, like that. Real values. Okay, they are known as continuous attributes. Now what do you call ordinal attributes? There is some order associated with it. What is that order? If you figure out ranking, rank 1, 2, 3, 4, there is some order associated with it, right? That's why you call it as ordinal attribute, that contains, that have meaningful sequence or order. Okay, see, I put that continuous ordinal attribute in the PPT so that people should not get, you know, they should not think, okay, where, what is this new? It's not new, first of all, but some people have this habit of studying only there, so they should not feel that what is this and all. So there only any new technical term I put it that, and you can see the way the font changes under. That is something which is not related to that, slide, but it's been put to for your own knowledge. OK, so potentially infinite number of values are mapped into small number of categories. You will probably not get to know this unless and until you see this example. Now, what is the example? The example is clearly saying what is data discretization. Okay, it is telling very clearly. See that first, you know, example. The example talks about what is known as the age, the attribute called age. Okay, and how many values it has? It has so many values. Okay, now they are called as what? Nominal attributes. They have real values, the nominal attributes. I want to put them in some order. What order? You see the discrete. After discretization, you see the example. I'm classifying everything based on young, mature, old. Okay, based on the age. Of course, the top board data is also age. I'm classifying them into three parts. That's called putting them in some sort of an order, ordinal attribute. Okay, transformation of the continuous attribute to a categorical attribute. So before that, we look into the hope you sort of understood that example. Okay, now based on this, you know, transformation, everything, it has what is known as a topic to be kept in mind. Okay, very important topic, very, very important thing to sort of know also. What is that? Okay. Transformation of a continuous attribute. Continuous is a value that is nominal, you know, having real values. Okay, continuous attribute to a categorical attribute. You're putting it in some sort of a category. Involves two subtasks. It has two subtasks. What is that? Deciding how many categories to have, number one. Number two, determining how to map the values of the continuous attributes to these categories. Okay, so these are the two subtasks that are done. First one is deciding how many categories to have. So first I decided, hey, let's have only three categories. Young, mature, old. Okay, first is done. Only three. Of course, I can split it into many categories I want. I can say young, I can say adult, I can say, okay, middle age, then I can say old age, four categories. So it all depends on how many categories you choose. Then what they say, determining how to map the values of the continuous attributes to these categories. So I decided, okay, anything less than 20, you put it as young. They are young only. Anything between 20 to 70, you put it in between mature, okay, or middle age. Anything after 70, I say, put it in your old age people. Okay, that is the second task, which is determining how to map the values of the continuous attributes to these categories. So where do you think this entire thing generally happens, the discretization? Discretization generally happens, as you see in the example, in classification. It's generally used in classification to classify data. Okay, that is something you should not forget. Next, the binarization. Now, what is binarization? There it is all about classification here. You are converting a data into some sort of a binary value. Clearly says binarization maps a continuous or a categorical attribute into one or more binary values. So what is it? Converting a continuous attribute to a categorical value. Categorical attribute means that you are able to put that data into some sort of a category. That's all, nothing more. Converting a continuous attribute to a categorical attribute, and then we are going to convert that categorical attribute to a set of binary attributes. Okay, what is this? There are two steps in one. First, continuous to category, category to binary. Where do you think this is used? In association analysis. What is association analysis? All these things you have studied. Okay, when you want to figure out the patterns between two or more things, which are always going in together, is known as association analysis. People buying bread will always buy jam. People buying milk will always try to bring, okay, even bread. Bread and jam, butter and milk, okay, or bread and butter, things that go together, okay. Sanitizer and mask. Now, the new example, right? Sanitizer and mask. Things like that, okay? Pen and pencil. Now, what's other things that you can think of? This internal is coming. So, what is the thing, okay, notes and pen to copy in the internals, okay, very easy to copy. Okay, people are saying, okay, now please keep your mobile, so you know what you call, camera on. Even with camera on, we know how to copy. That's called intelligence, that's called smart work. But be putting the effort, be, you know, behind, that's called hard work, okay, which is very much necessary for your exam. Okay, now typically using association analysis. Association analysis needs asymmetric binary attributes. What is asymmetric binary attributes? The ones which don't have zeros values. Okay, that doesn't have zero values. So for this, there is one big example. Okay, there's one very big example. This example is something which you need to learn, which you must study, which you need to learn. Okay, so what we do is, tomorrow, I think in tomorrow's class, I'm going to explain this in a numerical way. Okay, it's the same old example. You take any example for binarization in data mining, binarization in data analytics, this example will be there. You type that, go, you know, in Google, this example will come. Because this, again, it's a standard example for explaining. There are certain things which are very standard, okay, because it will sort of explain you each and everything. So we'll take this example, we'll do it mathematically tomorrow. Because I think from tomorrow, day after tomorrow's 2-3 classes, you're going to get lots of mathematical attributes that are going to come through. Okay, so I think till not here, before itself, you're going to there for your internals. The questions are there, please read for it. Okay, and one more thing, yeah, the notes, I think the PPT, I'll be sending it probably after this class, now itself. I think notes will not be having that last part of it. Last part, I'll be doing it. I'll be sort of putting it into PPT, the measures of similarity and dissimilarity. There's a topic called measures of similarity and dissimilarity. Okay, lots of equations that are there. Of course, only you need to read about equations. No more, you know, putting that into form of a mathematical perspective and all. No, that's not there. Okay, only equations. Certain equations will be very handy for your machine learning in 7th sem. Okay, so I'm going to send that notes also. It will be there in that Google Notes, sorry, Google Drive. I'll be sending the one more link for you again, the same old link I'll be posting here. Please go there and read that. Okay, yeah, fine. In the next class we'll meet and we'll go into talk about this. Very important things. Lots of mathematical equations will come in the next 1 or 2 classes. Okay, in the next class we'll meet and we'll discuss about it.